Any questions?
I'm going to let you know nothing's changed from 12 hours ago. So if there's no questions, fine by me.
Okay, Jeff, here in the front on one or two.
Jeff Shadell, News Herald. Kevin, your numbers in that first half were really good. Rebounding, did Golden State do something to make it more difficult in that second half?
No, I think more than anything, just I was spacing. I find myself, floating a little bit sometimes, and that's just due to most of the time in the third quarter, or a lot of the times we find ourselves a little stagnant, ball watching or just not moving the ball from side to side. I think that's been, one of the things for us throughout, this season and seasons past where, we come out in the third quarter and that tends to happen. So I think more than anything, it's at least for me, what I can do is just keep in the same mindset, continue to be aggressive.
So then how, since you know that, I mean, how, is it more difficult to do than to say coming up here for game four?
I mean, this is a team the Warriors, you really have to continue to put your foot on the gas. You can't let up. So, I think it was not just myself, but everybody. I think it's a mentality. Just continue to stay aggressive, get that ball from side to side. And we've always been better when we've played with pace. And I think that allows Bron to do what he does best, and that's get downhill and attack and, play in the open court and transition.
Over here on the right.
Kevin, Reed Forgrave with CBSSports.com. Obviously, you come out in game four and you're going to dry your guys' arms. But is there any sense of resignation where it's like two out of three of these games you guys could have won?
Mm-hmm.
And you did everything you could in those games, and yet the Warriors just find a way.
Right. Well, I think that's why they're such a great team. But we've given ourselves a chance. I know that we'll come out in game four and really compete. We're not going to give in. And, as you mentioned, I mentioned last night, too, just the margin for error is very slim against the Warriors. I mean, you almost have to be perfect. There was a lot of things last night that we did well, but there are a couple of blown coverages, a couple of missed shots that and timely shots that didn't go our way. That led to them winning the game. So, there's been game one, game three. I know that game two got away from us a little bit, but those are games that we were right there.
Standing on the left.
Kevin, John Gonzalez from The Ringer. It's obviously been a different sort of season for you guys. Ty was talking about that a little bit, about the difference between coaching guys he's been around for a while and then incorporating some new guys. So I was just wondering, in your experience, what it's like to play for Ty and then what you saw from him when you were trying to phase in those new pieces.
Yeah, I think just at least for me, there's been a big comfort level with Ty. I've always had a trust with him as well, personally. And then just he's had to deal with a lot. I mean, incorporating a bunch of new players, roster overhaul, and being the head coach of the Cavaliers, I've always said we thrive under chaos. So we have some sort of sense of that. But, he's taken everything in stride. I know he had a little bit of his health issues this year, but he's faced that head on and has been able to overcome all those.
Did you talk to him about the health issues while he was going through it? And what was that? Can you tell us anything about those conversations?
Well, I was pretty happy and not only empathetic, but was able to talk with him about some of the things that he's gone through off the court. So, and been able to admit that he's been facing some anxiety, I think, and everything that's come out about, at least with DeMar and guys like Kelly Oubre and myself that deal with that sort of thing off the court. I'm, extremely happy that he was able to face that and admit that. And, it's one of those things where I know that his health, he went through some stuff this year, but I would have never known he was dealing with anxiety like that. So he's taken everything in stride. He's grown a lot, I think, since he's been here. And, it's not just players that are able to grow and get through certain things and tough parts of their life, but coaches, too. I think it's pretty cool.
On your left, Dave.
Dave McMenamin, ESPN. Kevin, this season's not over. It could go four more games, but if you – we're going to look back at what you guys have done this year. What makes you feel good about 2017, 2018 for the Cavs?
I think we were able to persevere. I know it seems like every time I get up here or talk to you or Joe or Jason, and we always talk about how many seasons it feels like it's been this year. But just I think the perseverance, just being able to get through whatever's been thrown at us. And you know, I know that can be said for every single year, but I think this year was definitely the most trying for a number of those reasons that you know you guys saw throughout.
Mark in the middle.
Kevin, Mark Schwartz, ESPN. LeBron has been through it all in 15 years, and I know he always tells you guys, follow my lead. What has he shared about this type of situation, either right now or last year when you were in the same predicament?
Oh, he just, I know I said earlier, he never takes his foot off the gas. He continues to be a leader. He continues to be LeBron. And, you know, he just, a lot of times he is very vocal about it, and sometimes he just leads by example. But, you know, he's the type of guy that he wakes up every day, punches the clock, puts in his time, and, you know, we follow everything that he does. So, you know, it's tough to be in this situation. It's not the situation we want to be in. But, you know, last year we came out in one game four on our home floor, so we're hoping to do the same.
Over here on the right.
Kevin, Paul Antunes, ESPN Brazil. In 2016, you guys were down 3-1, won three straight games. Is there anything that you can draw from that experience that might help you have a little bit more confidence still in this series and try to do the supposedly impossible?
Yeah, I mean, it's you just got, I know it's cliche, but you got to take it one game at a time. I think that's what we did in that series. You know, we were able to get game three, obviously lost game four on our home floor, but we're able to win the next three. But, you know, for us, that margin of error is very small. And, you know, we know that if you know, we keep our coverages tight, we foul when we're supposed to or when we need to. You know, we switch when we're supposed to. We don't let them slip to the rim, get those easy buckets that are deflating. And then on the offensive end, in the third quarter, we don't get stagnant and play a full 48 minutes of moving the ball and playing our game. And we'll give ourselves a chance, and we feel like we can win.
Kristen Crick, USA Today. I just want to go back to mental health for a second. For you, what tactics do you use in times of adversity like this to quiet your mind so that maybe you don't slip into thinking too far into the future or thinking back into the past?
Yeah, I think as far as basketball goes, it's always been my safe place. Every time I've stepped up onto the floor, I've felt free, and it's a you know, kind of a way to get away from those stresses. It's away from the court where I feel like your mind can play tricks on you, and you know, if you try to quiet your mind too much, it's like trying to fall asleep at night. You start thinking of the stupid things you've done the last 10 years of your life, and you know, all sort of negative thoughts creep in. But just you know, be around good people, positive energy, and you know, and a lot of people do different things to manage their stress and anxiety and depression. And you know, I have my own coping mechanisms as well, but I think everybody's different.
Is meditation a part of that?
Meditation is huge. Yeah. I think it's you know, my uncle had done TM now for 40 or 50 years, and that's something he's tried to get me into. But there's certain apps that you can use too, or you know, listen to, you know, different white noises type of things. I know this is maybe boring for some of you guys, but I love this stuff. So it's something I, you know, really look to, and hopefully I can make an impact, especially this summer moving forward.
Last two, Ken in the back left, and then Joe up front.
Kevin, Ken Berger from Bleacher Report. In this league, there's always somebody plotting to form the next super team to deal with the current one, whether it was you and LeBron and Kyrie teaming up, LeBron going to Miami, KD going to Golden State, and now this summer there'll be the next wave. How do you view that dynamic as a player? Is that sort of disquieting? Is it you look at it as an opportunity for players to have the chance to move around and team up? And, you know, how does that strike you?
I don't know. I guess I've never really had to answer that question. I feel like, you know, I think if you have a chance to win in this league, you have to go for it. I mean, I can remember when, you know, I had missed, you know, the playoffs six straight years, and I, you know, kind of decided that I wanted to win, and, you know, ended up, you know, being in a bunch of trade scenarios and ended up here and, you know, winning in 2016, but, and teamed up with LeBron and Kyrie and, you know, all those guys that won on the 2016 team. But, you know, now you see Morey talking about it with the Rockets and, you know, them trying to team up and do whatever they can. They become, you know, what he said the other day, that he's a 10 of 10 on obsessed with beating the Warriors. So, you know, that Rockets team is, you know, like they always say, they're built to try to beat them, and they went to seven games in the Western Conference Finals. So I think you'll see a lot of that around the league, and that's always going to be the talk because, I mean, somebody has to, you know, try and dethrone these guys and, you know, work their way to that. So it's, you know, we're not out of this series. We've got another game tomorrow. We need to fight. But I think, to your point, at least in the offseason, I think you'll see a number of guys, a lot of movement, and, you know, that's going to continue to happen until there's some sort of parity.
Joe, last one on the front.
Joe Varden, Cleveland.com. Kevin, as you well know, your name comes up in the summer on about trades and things like that. I think you have 2 years left on your deal, mm-hmm. and it's hard to say what's going to happen here this summer. Do you expect to be back next season, or how do you view your future coming here in Cleveland?
Yeah, I mean, I'd hope so. I've always said that. I've always wanted to be here. Always wanted to win here. But as you know, it's probably going to come up. It always does. You know, it's. Also good to be wanted, but, you know, at the same time, you know, it's going to be interesting to see what happens. We just don't know. There's been so much overhaul and so many things that have happened this year, particularly with our team, that, you know, you just don't know. When July comes and free agency hits, you know, there could be something interesting, you know, that comes up for this team. And, you know, knowing that it's a business, you just have to, I know that it's cliche to say take it in stride, but, you know, that's just what I've had to do. Keep my mouth shut, go about my business, and, you know, work and be ready and be prepared for this team next year.
Thank you, Kevin.
Cool. Thanks, guys.